Congress is back in session, and you know what that means. Welcome to another episode of Congressional Solutions, the only show that says, don't worry, Congress has a solution for that non-sarcastically. Today we're talking about drugs. No, not the fun ones, the ones that Americans can't afford. In a surprisingly civil arrangement, on Thursday, New Jersey's 6th District Democratic Representative Frank Palone introduced the Lower Drug Costs Now Act of 2019. A few hours later, though, Trump just eviscerated this plan on Twitter by writing, "It's great to see Speaker Pelosi's bill today. Let's get it done in a bipartisan way." Well, that's encouraging. Of course, this bill is not without its opponents. Mitch McConnell has said that this bill is dead on arrival if it shows up to the Senate. Which, it's a healthcare bill, man. Maybe don't use the term dead on arrival. Today my goal is simple, summarize what's in the bill. Now this thing is more than 100 pages and one of the least fun pieces of summer reading I've ever had to binge read in a day. So if I miss your favorite nuanced policy change, let me know in the comments. I'll link to the entire bill in the description, just in case any of you are having trouble sleeping tonight. Until then, take it away, Frank Palone.
I really want to stress that the status quo is simply unacceptable. Something needs to be done, and we're going to do it. The problem right now is that the drug companies basically charge whatever they want.
Wow, that guy's pretty quiet for someone supposed to be representing New Jersey. The main thrust of this bill is it empowers the Secretary of the Department of Health and Human Services to negotiate directly with drug companies about the prices of their products in the United States. And just like that, I think you can tell why this is all so controversial. Of course, in this case, the devil is in the details, so let's get into it. Now for those of you reading along, this part of the video is summarizing Title 1, Lowering Prices Through Fair Drug Price Negotiation. The first question I had was, who benefits from this? Healthcare wonks, a group that is still somehow cooler than us legislation wonks, will note that, gee, this all sounds awfully familiar. Sounds a lot like the Medicare drug price negotiations that Democrats have been trying to get passed since that negotiation was banned in 2003. This is one of the most significant changes that this legislation makes over previous proposals. In this case, for those of us unlucky few who aren't about to turn 65, and therefore get Medicare, the beneficiaries of this plan are people enrolled under a Medicare prescription drug plan, enrolled under a group health plan, or health insurance coverage offered in the group or individual market. Basically everybody except the uninsured will now have not only the free market, but also the Department of Health and Human Services trying to push down prices. You hear that, Big Pharma? Now you're gonna have to negotiate with ex-pharmaceutical executive and lobbyist turned HHS secretary Alex Azar. Feels good to finally have someone fighting on our side. For this next part, I took a deep dive into a very shallow rabbit hole to try to figure out exactly how these Medicare negotiated prices would also be applied to private insurers. And it turns out the answer is incredibly simple. If you don't give insured Americans the same price, we'll fine you. For this answer, we go to the bill's summary sheet, which, in hindsight, probably should have searched for answers there a little bit sooner. Brace yourself for this large wall of text, though. Whew, yeah, Frank Palone is barely peeking out over the top of that one. Generally, I wouldn't go into this much detail, but this is the main innovation of this bill over its competitors. It says, a manufacturer would also be required to offer the negotiated price to the commercial market, to group and individual health insurance plans. If a manufacturer has agreed to a maximum fair price and then overcharges Medicare or fails to offer the maximum fair price to other payers, the manufacturer would be subject to a civil monetary penalty equal to 10 times the difference between the price charged and the maximum fair price for the drug. At the same time, I want to re-emphasize that if you don't have insurance under this plan, hope you like suppositories, because Big Pharma still has you over a barrel. So now the next question you're probably asking, is there a mechanism to get drug companies to the negotiating table? I mean, it's really easy to write laws, but, and this might surprise you, pharmaceutical companies are not exactly notorious for being the most legally obedient groups out there. So what's to stop Martin Shkreli from saying, I know we were planning on negotiating making my drugs cheaper, but then I realized that I'd make a lot more money if I ignored that, so I decided to explore that path instead. Well, this bill would implement a fee system where the federal government starts out charging 65% of the sales generated from that drug, and that amount gets bumped up 10% to 75%, 85%, and finally 95% for every quarter of non-compliance. Never makes it to 100% though, that would be socialism. So those are the parameters of the negotiations. It's to determine the cost of the drugs paid by people with insurance, and there is a punishment system in place if you refuse to negotiate with the government. Now let's get a little deeper into the parameters of what these negotiations actually look like, because it actually seems like the author who wrote this, at least in part, had the idea of a conflict of interest with the Health and Human Services Secretary in mind. It's at this point that this legislation borrows an idea from Bernie Sanders.
We will look at the average costs of prescription drugs in Canada, the UK, Germany, Japan, and France. Well, we will look at their average costs, which are 50% lower than they are in the United States, and we will do that.
It's not exactly the same, but it's clear that someone was sneaking a peek at someone else's legislation. For each drug that the Department of Health and Human Services decides to negotiate, they have an average international market price working as a benchmark. Fair warning, this next quote from the bill is a bit of a Frankenstein's monster of internal citations. Because, well, this law refers to itself a lot. Average international market price means, with respect to a drug, the average price for any dosage form and strength of a unit of the drug for sales of such drug in Australia, Canada, France, Germany, Japan, and the United Kingdom. What this means is, basically, we're creating this benchmark cost that is the average of what all these countries pay. Now that might sound like another fun side project designed to just bum everybody else out about our situation. But it has a practical application. This legislation uses it to create a maximum fair price for a selected drug that shall not exceed 120% of the AIM price. So Congress has gotten together and decided, it's official, drug companies, you can only rip off Americans a little bit. Selling it for 20% more than you do everywhere else? Well, that's just good business. Bio reports this 20% number was entirely arbitrary. But according to Nancy Pelosi's gut, it feels like a number that's big enough to not be socialist, but small enough to not let exploitation continue too much. Before we move on, this proposal has one other entirely arbitrary piece to it that has more radical House Democrats up in arms. The Department of Health and Human Services cannot negotiate more than 251 drugs a year. At maximum, 125 yearly negotiated drugs come from Part D drugs for which there was an estimated greatest net spending under Medicare. 125 of these drugs come from an estimated greatest net spending in all of the United States, as determined by the Secretary. And lastly, we have just insulin. They get their own special negotiation designation because Big Pharma has done an exceptionally good job ripping off that market. The question here, of course, is why limit the HHS? I mean, no senator out there is getting on the bully pulpit to say, this is socialism and we should vote against... Oh wait, the government's only negotiating 251 drugs a year? Can I change my vote, please? The stated reason for this is to balance two interests, maximizing the impact on prescription drug spending while theoretically keeping the list of negotiable drugs to a number that the HHS could handle. Whether this is a good assessment or not is up to us. On the other hand, there's also a minimum of 25 drug negotiations that a secretary would be compelled to do by this law every year. Now that means that even if Raymond Sackler himself were HHS secretary, he would have to negotiate with companies over 25 drugs minimum and lower their prices to the low price of 20% more than the rest of the world pay. Let's just hope the rest of the world have good negotiators.
I've heard all kinds of people say how the drug company is going to find a way to get around this. You know, someone suggested, well, they'll just raise prices in the six countries we're using for the international price. But I mean, you know, we're doing our best to make this so that it is going to save money. And I'm sure, you know, somebody's going to try to figure out a way around it. But, you know, then we'll just have to deal with that.
Sounds like a man with a plan. So that's the crux of this bill. But there are a few other goodies scattered in here. This is going to be a bit of a legislative lightning round. We got Title II, Medicare Parts B and D, Prescription Drug Inflation Rebates. Man, there is some stiff competition for the least interesting word in that title. The basic idea here is, according to the bill's summary, if you're a drug company that has raised the price of a drug in Part B or D above the rate of inflation since 2016, they can either lower the price or be required to pay the entire price above inflation in a rebate back to the Treasury. That's pretty self-explanatory. Lastly, and definitely leastly, we have Title III, Part D improvements and maximum out-of-pocket caps for Medicare beneficiaries. Now this one is only for people over the age of 65 and on Medicare. But now, once they spend more than $2,000 on prescription drugs, the government will take over completely. That number currently sits at $5,000. So that's the drug pricing bill that was just proposed by Nancy Pelosi's team. I hope I helped some of you understand exactly what is going on here. Link to both the summary and the bill in the description. Although, in a perfect example of congressional ineptitude and incompetence, there are some major differences between the summary and the bill itself, including different regulations and a whole title that was missing from the final bill, about investing billions of dollars into looking for treatments, cures, and expanding Medicare to cover vision and dental. So don't just blindly trust the summary. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello, YouTube! If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Ring that bell so the freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.